you very much. Hello, can you hear me?
Wait.
Okay. Thank you. thank you very much for the organizer for giving me such an opportunity to present our work. And it's a great meeting. And today I'm going to talk about the neural mechanisms underlying the facial expressions in macaques. So we all know facial expression is very important. It's not only for individual survivals, also for the group survivals. Before we learn how to talk, we already learned how to present our facial expressions, like the baby here. And when the baby is very young, like a couple days or even just a couple hours after they're born, they already start to represent their facial expression, let us know they are hungry, they are happy, they are unhappy. So the ability to perceive and discriminate the facial expression is very important for social communication. And however, the neural base underlying the facial expression remains unclear. Oh, wait a second, sorry, missed one slice. Okay, so this is when we grow up, our facial expression become more, you know, juiceful. And okay, so we know the amygdala is a very important region for our emotion process. And so how to study amygdala in humans? And we all know amygdala is a very deep brain structure. So it's hard to study it using like EEG. So we need to use things like fMR. By using fMR, when we present different facial expression to human subjects like fearful, happiness, and we can find the activations in amygdala. You can see here. And this is a time cross. You can see the fearful is stronger than neutral, and happy is also stronger than neutral. And this is what we called valence effect. So to further investigate this kind of the facial expression and processing, and we need to auto the brain activity, such as we need to auto the activities in amygdala, then we can see what happened to the facial expression processing. And it's very hard to do that in human subjects. And so we need some animal models. And what kind of animal models we can use? And we need some animal models, they share very similar genome and anatomy and behavior and these things as humans. So that leaves non-human primates. You can see here, there's a lot of non-human primates. And which of them can be our subjects? And because of some rules, it's hard for us to use animals like chimpanzee, and it's almost forbidden to use them in the lab. So that let us can use rhesus macaque as a model to study the facial expressions. So it will be very good models. Then how we can study facial expression in monkeys? We all know we used to use single unit recording in monkeys. It's a very classical and a traditional method and a very powerful method. But the problem is that when we use electro recording, most of the time we can only record one side or one cell. So we cannot look into the whole network of the facial expression processing. So we need a method to investigate the whole network at time. So what we can do? So that here's what we are going to do. We are going to use fMR in monkeys. So by using this method, we can do what we did in humans. So we can scan the animals when they're looking at the different facial expression. Then you may ask, do animals, they have the facial expressions? Yes, they do have facial expressions. So this is four very common or typical facial expressions we can find in macaques. So the first one is neutral. Sorry, it's a very tiny, I cannot really, okay, find it. So this is neutral, and okay. Yeah, I can use the mouse, that may be better. Yeah, this is too tiny. So this is neutral, and this is a threat, and it's an open mouth threat. And this is the fear grin, and it's a fearful expression. And this is lip smack, and or you can call it appeasing. And These two, the threat and the fear green, most of the time we can call that is negative facial expression. And the lip smack, we cannot find the equal facial expression in human like lip smack because we don't do that. But it's kind of happy things. When monkey do that, it means he wants the food or the juice from you, or he wanted to show you the friendly. So this is kind of the happy, positive facial expressions. So by using fMR, we can find the amygdala, like human's amygdala, it responds differently to different facial expression. In different monkeys, the amygdala's response is different, but the most common thing is here. So the amygdala will respond more stronger to fearful expression compared to the neutral expression. For some monkeys, you may also find the stronger response in threat or in the lip smack, but this one is the most consistent finding you can find in monkeys. And so this is what we call the valence effect, as we just said for humans. And by people here may already heard about like the face-like regions in monkeys, and by using different face localizer stimulus like face, object, and place, we contrast response to face versus place. We can localize the face select regions in the temporal lobe. And these regions, they also have different response to facial expressions, of course, because facial expression is carried by face. And here's it. So you can see, and the black circle here, and mark the face select regions, which we call the middle face select regions. And also here we have the anterior face select regions. So these regions also have different response to different facial expression. And here's what we said. For the fear green, it's most consistent. But for other facial expression, for some monkey, we can see stronger response compared to the neutral. But for some monkey or some region, we cannot see that. So the face select regions is not the only one outside the amygdala we can find such valence effect. We can also find such valence effect in the prefrontal cortex, such as two very famous regions related to the emotion processing, OFA, optal prefrontal cortex, and the VLPFC, the ventrolateral prefrontal cortex. So in these two regions, we can also find the valence effect here. And now you can see again, for the fear green, it's most consistent. For others, we also can see some here. So now the question we want to ask is, what is the function relationship among these face process, facial expression process regions? And is there any region is the hub, or is there any region receive the input feedback, feed forward, something like that? And the first, we wanted to look into the amygdala, because this is the most famous regions for control the emotion. So what we do is we want to do the lesion in the amygdala. We want to block out the amygdala to see what will happen to the monkey's facial expression perceiving. And so we inject the arbitonic acid into the amygdala. After we inject this kind of acid, and we put the monkey again back to the scanner, and we examine the injection location. So you can see there's a big hole, so that indicates the cell there has been killed by this acid. Then we can start to use these animals as an animal model to study the effect of the amygdala on facial expression. So the first thing is that we want to ask whether this amygdala lesion monkey still have the face process ability, that is, whether they still have face-like regions. So we first present a face localizer task to these monkeys. So we present like face, object place again to these monkeys. And here's what we found. So the black circle here and indicate the location of face-like regions in this amygdala lesion monkey. So you can see we still can find the face-like regions after amygdala lesion. So that is the amygdala lesion will not affect the face processing, the normal face processing. Then you may wondering whether it will affect the facial expression processing. Here's what I'm going to show you next. Amygdala is, if you have looked at the anatomy, at least you will know amygdala is a small region, like why it's called amygdala, because it's, the shape is like amygdala. And it has the, it's not very, it's small, but not very small. So, and the Pierre's anatomical study already shows the projection from amygdala back to the IT cortex shows anterior to posterior projection. So we want to see if we lesion the different part of the amygdala, whether the IT response will show different pattern. So here's what we do. So first thing is we did the lesion in the posterior part of the amygdala. Showing on the left is the intact amygdala. You can see circled by the yellow line. And on the right clone is the monkey have the posterior amygdala lesion. It's a big black hole here. So for these monkeys, and we look their face select regions. So if you look at the anterior face patch, you can see the blue bars is the data from the normal monkey. That is the monkey has amygdala. So you can see the very clear balance effect, stronger response to fear green and compared to the neutral. And if you look at this amygdala lesion monkey, you still can see the valence effect, the stronger response to fear green compared to the neutral. However, if you move your eyes to the middle face patch, and you can see the middle face patch, of course, in the normal subject, you will see the valence effect. However, if you look into the amygdala lesion monkey, you can see it's a flat. So there's no difference across different facial expression. So that is when we did the lesion in the posterior amygdala, the valence effect in the middle face patch, that is more posterior compared to the anterior face patch, the valence effect here, there has been eliminated. Then you may be wondering, if we do the lesion in the anterior amygdala, what will happen? So here's what we do next. So this is the anterior part of the amygdala. Here's what we did the lesion there. So you can see, anterior part of the amygdala is relatively small, so it's hard for you to see the black hole, but you still can see there's some tiny hole there and indicate the lesion area. So in these monkeys, you can see in the anterior face patch, there's no valence effect. And however, opposite to the result I just showed you, in the middle face patch, you can see the stronger response to the fear green compared to the neutral. So that is, you still can find the valence effect in the middle face patch. So that is, this lesion study tells us the feedback projection from the amygdala to the face patch modulates the valence effect what we found in the face patch. However, these effects are consistent to an anterior to posterior granularity of the projection. So that is the anterior part of the amygdala project to the anterior face patch. The posterior part of the amygdala will project to the middle face patch. So now we have some idea about how the amygdala modulated the facial expression processing in the temporal lobe. Now we are going to move to the prefrontal lobe. So for the to study the prefrontal cortex the effect, we are going to change our method to the dynamic cultural modeling. So this modeling is very helpful tool in the human project, because in human studies, it's hard for them to inactivate or lesion some area, but they still want to know the causal relationship among different nodes. So they can use this model to calculate the causal relationship among the different nodes. But to our knowledge, it haven't been tested in the monkey fMRI before our work. So the first thing we want to do is we want to make sure this method works in the monkey data. So the first thing we want to see is whether we can use this model to model the finding we just find by the lesion study. So the first thing is we build up a model. So this is our basic model. So in this model, we choose the nodes like anterior TE. That is where the anterior face patch located, and the TEO, that which is the middle face patch located, and also amygdala, OFC, and VLPFC. And this blue line indicate the input to this model, and the red line is the connections based on the purest anatomic knowledge in the monkeys. So we have we separate these models to three types. The first step is called the feed-forward model. So in this model, you can see the black line is our model coupling. So it's from TEO to TE, from TE to amygdala. And then we have feedback model. So in this model is mainly three tabs. From amygdala, go back to TE, and from TE to TEO, or from amygdala to both TE and TEO, or amygdala to TE, TEO, or another way from amygdala to TEO again. We also have the third type of the model, that is both feed-forward and feedback model. So in this model, basically, we just combine this and with this together. So totally, we have seven models here. So we use DCM method and to calculate which one is the winner model. And after we calculated that, we found this is a winner model. So that is amygdala send the feed-forward feedback information to TE and TEO. So this is consistent to what we found by using amygdala region method. So now we feel a little bit comfortable to move forward to examine the function coupling between the prefrontal cortex and the rest nodes in this network. Okay, so now the further model will based on this winner. So we set up a lot of models. This is some samples in this model, and we model the different connections between OFC to TE and amygdala, or between the OFC and the VLPFC. So again, we calculated the winner model here. And what we found here is the winner model is So the winner model is this one. Let me see. Winner model, it's hard to see here. This one. So the winner model is this one. So the VLPFC send the feedback information to the amygdala and also the anterior face patch, but not the middle face patch. So now we can feed this network a little bit more. And so we found by using the DCM method, we found the balancing effect is modulated by the feedback connections from the prefrontal cortex to the amygdala and also the anterior face patch. So next is we want to change this network. We want to see how can we modulate this network. And we are going to use a very famous hormone. It's called oxytocin. Oxytocin can affect a lot of social behavior, and especially how people recognize facial expressions. It has been done a lot of studies in human subjects. But in monkeys, this very good model, that's very little work has been done in monkeys. If we want to use oxytocin as a treatment for some mental disorder, and we need to make sure how it works, so we really need a monkey model to estimate the oxytocin effect. So that's why we conducted this study. So oxytocin, usually how we treat a monkey with oxytocin, we all use the nasal spray. And because oxytocin itself is hard to go through the blood-brain boundary, and people believe if we go through the nasal, and it can go through the blood-brain boundary and come into the brain. Okay, so let's see how it works. So let's look into the amygdala first. Of course, in amygdala, again, we can find the stronger response to fear green compared to the neutral, the valency effect. Then after we give the monkey oxytocin, what happened? And this is the orange bars shows the result from the oxytocin result. And if you just look at that, it's not very obvious what happened. But if we add a line here, it's very obvious. So you can see there's two drop down. One happens to the response to the fear green. Another one happens to the threat. So these two facial expressions, they have one common accept. That is, both of them are negative facial expression. Then let's look at the neutral one. So you can see for the neutral facial expression, there's no change. So oxytocin does not change the response to the neutral facial expression. And how about the relative positive one? That is a lip smack. So you can see the lip smack still stronger than the neutral. There's no change to this positive facial expression. So that is oxytocin selectively changes the response to negative facial expression. And this is what we found in amygdala. How about the other regions, like prefrontal cortex, anterior face patch, middle face patch? And we found very consistent result through all the regions. We can find a valency effect and include the temporal lobe, anterior face patch, posterior face patch, and the prefrontal cortex, OFC, FEV, LPFC. Then we are wondering what causes these kind of changes, like which region may be the key nodes L2C may work and change this function and response. So we look at the function connectivity under different facial expression and between the placebo condition and oxytocin condition, and we contrast them to see what happened. So showing here, first you can see is the function connective changes when monkey look at the neutral. So basically you can see there's no any star, so that means there's no significant changes when we give monkey oxytocin. It does not change the function couplings among these regions and when monkey look at the neutral facial expression. And how about the lip smack? So you can see for the lip smack, there's almost no star again. So that is oxytocin does not change the function coupling when monkey look at the neutral and the lip smack facial expressions. Then what will happen to the negative facial expression? So, wow, you can see that's a lot of stars. So that means a lot of function couplings has been changed after we give monkey oxytocin. So the most important or most obvious things happens here. So you can see here. So this is the amygdala, the function coupling between amygdala and the visual cortex, include the primary visual cortex and the temporal lobe. So that is the red color here indicated the reduced function coupling here. So that is when we give the monkey oxytocin, the oxytocin selectively reduce function coupling between amygdala and visual cortex. Here is it. So oxytocin can reduce both response, FMR response, and function coupling during the viewing of fearful and aggressive faces. So let's go over our take-home message. So through our FMR study combined with Legion method, DCM method, and pharmacology method, and we found amygdala will modulate the valence effect we found in the anterior face patch and the middle face patch. And the prefrontal cortex, especially VLPFC, will also modulate the response in amygdala and anterior face patch. And oxytocin, this is probably very useful hormone, can modulate the neuron couplings between the amygdala to the temporal lobe. And here's my collaborator and also my peers supervisor at NIH, and thank you for attention.
Okay, now it's open for questions and comments. Yeah, I have a quick question about the statistics. So when you show the functional couple, how do you handle the multiple comparison? Looks like you have a big matrix, right?
Right. For this comparison, we compare. So for this one is, I don't know why it's not there. Yeah. So we compare. So this is under one condition, like fearful, we compare between placebo and oxytocin, and this is a within subject comparison, because this is same monkey. We compare the data when the monkey received setting and compare with the same monkey received the oxytocin. I'm not sure whether that answers your question.
So you're comparing a big number of those. So are you correct for?
Yes, we did the multiple comparison correction. We did that. Yes.
Okay.
That's also a question the review asked, and we did do that, yes.
So I was wondering what you thought of these influences from one region to the next. In a lot of these areas have bidirectional connections.
Yes.
So how do you decide which direction this is going? The
Okay, so such as when we set up the DCM models, we track the anatomical connections between different regions. So that's another benefit that we can use monkey, because in humans, actually, we are not pretty sure the connection is there. For the monkeys, we know there's a connection, such as we know there's connections between amygdala and the TEO, and maybe it's a feedback connections. And also, there's no so far no evidence from VLPFC to the TEO. So this is our anatomical base. And when we perform the further study, it's based on these findings.
Can I say, you know, one issue that arises from these mm-hmm. connections is that, you know, normally it's done using tracers, right?
Yes.
Like take the PFC from the amygdala connection,
mm-hmm.
and it's always been set to an excitatory connection,
mm-hmm.
which is glutamate in that connection.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, when you record down in the amygdala and you turn on the prefrontal cortex,
uh-huh.
the major impact is inhibition.
Mm-hmm.
Yes,
so that's, go ahead.
Basically, the connection is an inhibitory connection, not an excitatory one.
Sorry, I'm not
quite. From the PFC to the amygdala.
Uh-huh.
Okay, while it's glutamate.
Yes, so far, based on the DCM model, it's from PFC to amygdala, not the opposite one. So
no, but I'm wondering how you differentiate excitatory versus inhibitory connections.
Oh, that is hard to do. By using the DCM models, but if we use other methods, like we inactivate amygdala or active amygdala, then that may help us to see the prefrontal cortex data, but we haven't done that yet. Yeah.
The question here is, what field strength are you doing the MRI?
3T. Part of the data, like the amygdala lesion data, we collect the data at 3 Tesla, and for the oxygen data, we collect at 4.7 Tesla.
Okay, because it might be interesting in the future to look at the laminar specific. There's a laminar specific version now
mm-hmm.
for DCM.
Uh-huh. I see. I haven't tried that, but I'm very. I love to try that. If yeah, we can talk about that.
Yeah. Any more questions?
Thank you.